live from Studio B in downtown Houston, learning the masters with Ginger Cook. Ginger, the floor is yours, I think.
Okay, hi everybody. I want to welcome you to this sort of impromptu live video blog show. John and I got some new equipment, and we tried to decide about 2 hours ago what we might do for a live show, and I thought, you probably don't want to hear me talk about how great John is for 2 hours, so and my friend's getting a little tired of that. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about Edgar Degas. He was an impressionistic painter.
Hey, let me pop his picture up for a second.
Yeah, put his picture up, John. This is great. We're testing all this equipment. Edgar Degas, lived in the, between, 1844, and he died about 1917. Why do we care? In other words, this isn't a history class. What we're going to focus on today is he did over 1,000 paintings, and I've seen at least 800 of them, and studied his, been really studying his work. And how can that help us as artists? In other words, what can we take away today and learn, and what we incorporate in our own artwork today, okay? Because he was a master draftsman. That's one of the things that they said about him, was a man could draw. He had just mad skills. And, nobody gets mad skills overnight, do they? But we can take some of the things that he did, and we can incorporate them right now, and we're gonna just go over a few things. I have his biography out. I kind of took some interesting things from his bio. John's got some pictures of him up. That's a self-portrait. He thought highly of himself. He was born in France, but interestingly, if Andrew's watching, Andrew is one of my students from gingercooklive.gallery that he lives in Haiti, and Andrew's grandfather was French. He was born in Haiti and eventually ended up in New Orleans, and the family somehow ended up in France. And, well, they all had, spoke French and had French backgrounds. And so, Degas grew up in France. When he was in high school, he took up what we consider, his teenage years, he turned his bedroom into an art studio. His mother died at the age of 13. And really, if any of you have ever gone through any kind of tragedy, you know that painting really helps. Painting just takes your mind off of everything. And so his father and his grandfather were his main influences. And so when we talk about that, I think it's rather very interesting. He was a loner. He was known for his portrait. He really reminded me a little bit, Norman Rockwell was our American artist. Some of you remember Norman Rockwell. He was illustrated the Saturday Evening Post for years, and he kind of captured Americana. Well, what Degas did before him was he captured life in France at that period. He was an historian, kind of a present-day historian of life in France. He was very drawn to the ballet. Now, because he was born wealthy, he could pretty much do what he pleased, paint what he pleased. He was above having to sell anything. He just did whatever he wanted to, which is really great if you can do that. Now, later on in life, what happened was after his father died, he found out he was the oldest of five kids, and one of his brothers did this debt thing that was horrible, and he ended up selling his own personal house and the whole family collection of art in order to bail his brother out, which was pretty nice, I think. And then, who hasn't bailed a few family relatives out in our time, right? All of us, I'm sure, have done it for somebody. And then what he did was, he thought now he suddenly had to make a living. He started having to sell his artwork. And so when you read his biography, you kind of understand where it came from. And collectors, if you've ever read novels, Pierce Anthony is a good example of a science fiction artist, author. He's an artist, okay? And so when he reached out and started to paint other genres, nobody wanted to read it. Again, Stephen King is known for his horror kind of stories, and so nobody wants to read a romance novel for him unless something happens to the person, So if there's nothing that happens, nobody wants to read that. And well, the same thing happens with artists. What happens is when you start to narrow your creativity down to a niche, and which is what the public demands, because they start collecting you. They want to collect. In his case, it was probably half his works are of the ballet. All right. And really a lot of that was because he needed to sell stuff, okay? And that, you need to, in order to sell stuff, you need a reputation. Now, in France at that time, when he was starting as a burgeoning artist, you know, a lot of people couldn't stand what he painted. And it's extraordinary to me because the guy was so good. And the critiques, you know, there's always critics out there going, well, look, we have a few here. I bet somebody puts a thumbs down on this before they've even heard the whole video. There's always somebody with a thumbs down, and those art critiques were brutal. But he eventually left the classical painting style of his time, and he started hanging out with the other impressionist artists. And when they started their own art shows, he was the guy that was sort of, you know, he had a lot of, you know, he hadn't lost his money at that point. He had some time, and he's the one that organized those shows. The thing of it is he just wanted things his way. He was a bit of a dictator. We'll talk more about that. Let me show you some of his paintings now. Can we focus down, John, here on the table, right?
Of course we can.
And okay, so
mention his name again.
Edward Degas. Edward Degas. This is who we're talking about. Edward Degas. He was born in France in 1844. He died in 1917. And really, when you read his whole life, I don't think he was a particularly likable person, but he was greatly admired, particularly by his peers. His classical study, you know, one of the things that he did, which was, he went to the L'École des Beaux-Arts in France, and he really learned to draw and paint and really had this craftsmanship down. And there was one artist, I want to mention this, I'm putting my glasses on for a second and tell you, because I want to read this. His portraits are notable for their psychological complexity and their portrayal of human isolation. I mean, isn't that interesting? He felt that an artist, to be an artist, you should be alone. You should live alone. Your private life is your private life. He was kind of snotty, I think, really. And he was born wealthy enough, so he kind of got away with that. But you got to admire what he painted. And that's what I do. I admire what he painted. And what can we take away from that? So I've assembled a few of his paintings down here. We're going to go back to the table here. I have some of his paintings of just his, you know, his ballet stuff. And I want to just talk to you a little bit about what can we learn from him we can take away and put in our own work? Well, the thing that really caught my eye was his values, his lights and darks, all right? Very important, the lights and darks. So if you look at, say, let's see if I have a brush here I can use as a pointer. Like, for instance, in this piece, you've got this ballerina. She's backlit from whatever's going on behind her, all right? This is acting as a stop, all right? We've got a triangular picture pattern here. That's something we can talk about, triangular picture pattern.
Okay, can we just kind of hold this part? Just interrupt me for a second.
We can interrupt me for a second. We're testing out new equipment.
I'm going to go back to your main camera
We're going back to the main camera for a minute.
I'm going to reset the other one.
He's going to reset the other one. Okay, so basically, so what else can I tell you about him that was kind of interesting about him? This main camera. Sorry, wrong camera. All right, main camera. This, you know, I need signs on these cameras. Camera one, camera two. Main means nothing to me, John.
You
know,
the one with the tape on it. It has a fancy tape. See, it has a little smiley face.
Fine. All right. So John, again, we're setting equipment. This is the fun thing for this. So you're getting the skinny on this. And I think if this works out, if you guys like learning about this stuff, taking one of these old dead artists and kind of extrapolating from what they have painted, what we can incorporate in our own work, we'll do a whole series of these kind of spontaneous learning from the masters. So back to what we were trying to learn about him was that, you know, it doesn't hurt. One thing we can learn just from his biography, it doesn't hurt to be nice. They tried to like him, all the impressionists, because they liked what he did, but eventually he ended up dying alone, wandering the streets of Paris. He alienated everybody. You know, he just did. He just, he had opinions. You want to read more about them and about, you know, certain types of people that he just didn't think, you know, if he learned a model was, let's see, what was he? He fired a model once because she was Protestant. I think probably he was born a French Catholic. I mean, really, he had just strangest ideas about things. And yet, irrespective of all that, he was such an amazing artist. Are we ready to go to the table yet?
You can go now.
Let's go down to the little camera here to the table. We're going to go down to the table. I want to talk about this ballerina because the city behind us is lit up. That is the lightest light. Here's a piece of white paper here, guys. See my white paper? The whitest white is back here. A tiny dot of white on her on her flower, on her ear. There's a tiny bit here, not as bright here. And so, and these windows are not as bright. So he manages the light. So that's something you want to look at. When you're done with the painting, what I want you to do is make it into a black and white image, you know, use your smartphone, and look at how you've got your lights and darks, because his contrast and the lights are what, you know, like, for instance, on his date, like, see how I've highlighted a few things about his biography? That's what the lights do. So don't overuse white. Make sure you're glazing white back. That's something that you can learn from him. And here's another example of that. I'm going to just put this one out of the way. A little camera?
Yeah.
All right. So here's the other example, but I want it down on the table so you can see it. Can you see me? And
yes.
You can see the picture, picture, and picture?
They're not in their head, yes. Can you believe that?
Gosh.
I can see them do that.
Really? All right. So if you look at this picture of, gosh, look at all the people he put in there. I mean, you know how hard that is? I mean, that's just, his drawing skills were mad crazily good, okay? And I could see why, if you're drawing this good, if you're this good an artist, I'd see you could get a bit of an attitude and you'd get away with it, right? Because, you know, you're good, huh? Right? Okay, so I'm just saying, you know, it's hard, and particularly for guys, too. You know, guys get that attitude. Women tend to be a little more humble, but, you know, particularly,
Let's not go to the gender.
I'm sorry, in my time, I have met some snotty famous artists. You know, I knew this one artist, and he wouldn't be at a party with any other artists. Really, he wouldn't be at a party if there were other artists there, okay? And look, we artists, what we do is we make the world a happier place, right? We do, that's what we do. And he did, his paintings were fantastic, and we know more about life in France because of what he painted. But if you look at this one back here, down here, if you look at this, look at where the light is. The whitest thing here is this piece of notes.
One comment from the technical department. Because of your picture in the picture, I need you to take that picture you're looking at and slide it towards
like that.
Not quite that much. Come back. Right there.
All right.
Perfect.
All right. Do you see this little bit of white? If I take a piece of white paper, right, that is the whitest thing in this whole piece. Do you see that? There's a little bit on her. Dress, tiny bit of white here. There's some white coming, light coming from the door. All these other guys are kind of grayed out, right? And then you can chase the light around, a dot here, a dot there. Again, he manages the white. So that's fantastic, isn't it? Manage the white, all right? So that you just don't have white everywhere, okay? And how do you turn something down? Well, if you go to some of our lessons at gingercooklive.gallery, we teach you a little bit about glazing, how to turn on and off the lights. I think I've got some stuff on YouTube even about turning on and off the lights, but that's something that's important. And we've all got to remember it, because it's hard not to just sit there and have light everywhere. And the light is like, look, when a painting's hanging on a wall, there's nobody there to explain it, okay? In fact, it's often said that if you have to explain the painting, you should have written a book, okay? So basically, the painting has to explain itself. And what the light does is bring the viewer around and emphasize your picture pattern and your subject. If you think about, you know, when you're designing a painting, we don't talk a lot about this, but when you're designing a painting, you think about a lead actor. You've got the actors, you know, lead actors, which in this case is this ballerina, and that's maybe, and these two, all right, here. And this guy, you barely see the guy playing the violin. He's there, but you don't see him. I mean, he's just there, sort of an also-ran. So these two women are the stars of the show, and everybody else is the extras in the cast, okay? And he might be considered the supporting actors, yeah. You know, if you were giving an Academy Award to the group in here, all right? Now, notice this black, look at this black line here, the violin case, he's got it painted. So here's our picture pattern, okay? It's an S. Do you see this?
Can you pull it down a little bit towards you?
Can you pull it toward me? It's an S. So you've got this going this way and like this, okay? And then she's tilted back like this. So it's an S picture pattern, all right? And the top of this is curved, okay? It's an S. An S is a great picture pattern. In other words, it kind of flows, all right? So that was one thing. I really like that one. Now I'm going to show you this one, which I thought was great. Let me just turn it up this way. Now, this is interesting in that we've got this dark piano, all right? And again, you see another example.
Pull it kind down towards you a little bit.
Another example of an S picture pattern. Don't you see that? In just the position of the arms. Now, follow the leg up here to the arms, around the head this way, and up like this and back. See that? And remember, when you're painting, this is really important. I don't really paint with black. He did. And it's okay, but people overuse black. And for instance, notice how black this is compared to this dark line here. Here, he doesn't have pitch black over here to distract. So there's a little bit of dark here to keep your eye. Almost, you could almost say it was not only an S, but almost triangular too in the way it is. But there's a window here for the little center of it, you know, to give it the painting a little balance. He could have left it out. What would happen if he'd left it out? Would it have changed anything? Well, you know, it's still a nice painting, but what the window did was give you some continuity. Where are they? Well, they're obviously in some sort of studio. I see some. You see in the background of the window, you see some skyscrapers, some buildings. So maybe they're on the second floor. He told you something. He's a fantastic illustrator. He told you the story, and somebody's foot hurts. I mean, there's so much going on in this painting. It's absolutely great. Besides, again, look at the light. Look at the white is white, a little bit of white here, a little bit of light here. That yellow, boy, yellow is lighter than white. Did you guys know that? You know, a light yellow is considered even lighter than white. Oh, I bet you didn't know that. Yeah, it's true. Like if you're painting waves and you want something, everybody thinks you do the white highlights on the waves, but in our Wave and Water Masterclass, we show you that this yellow, look how much brighter this little flower is than anything else. See that? It is. You can see it.
These are oil paintings, right?
These are all oil paintings. Sometimes he did pastels. And one of the things that this one artist was very famous at the time, it's in his biography. I think I have it over here. This one guy, and he told him, let me put my glasses on, I hate to paraphrase. The guy was named Jean Ingres, I-N-G-R-E-S, who Degas, he said, revered. Revered means, boy, this was a snotty guy. For him to revere anybody is extraordinary, okay? And he said that, in 1855, he met him, and the quote was, and he repeated it often, "Draw lines, young man, and still more lines, both from life and from memory, and you will become a good artist." Now, interestingly, I want to share this with you. This is exciting. This is my video blog. I get to share whatever I want. I'm sharing some stuff. Okay.
Wait. I control the cameras. I can turn you off if you get crazy.
Oh.
Just saying.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm. Who's crazy? No. All right. So there's this man in, I don't remember where, in San Francisco. He's a big deal art teacher somewhere up there. Just leave it at that. And he has his students, and I thought this was some of the best advice I'd ever seen. He tells you to have like a little notebook, like about like this, little tiny notebook, something you put in your back pocket or purse, and a little pencil. And every day, take 10 minutes, you can time it, take 10 minutes and draw something. And if you're at a restaurant, maybe it's a salt and pepper shaker, maybe it's a fork, maybe it's something. And don't date it and do not show this to anybody, no matter how magnificent. Do this for a year and see how good your drawing skills get. I mean, I challenge you. This is January 1st. This is the time to do it. Happy New Year's, everybody. This is the time to do that. Let's all do that. I'll tell you what, John, we'll do it too. John and I will do it with you.
Wait, what are we doing?
See, you're not paying attention. Yeah, you can't cut me off. He's not even listening. What does that tell you? He's not listening.
I'm over here watching the cameras, watching the chat. Hey, this is a busy place over here.
Okay, all right. So I say I'll do it too. We'll all get these little notebooks. And I'll tell you what, he said don't show it to anybody, but let's once a month pick our best picture and show it. Should we do that?
Ooh, I like that.
We'll do that. And on a little sketch. It's got to be like 3 inches by 2 inches. A little tiny sketch. It's a little notebook, like a little scribble notebook, and even just a little tiny thing, and you have it in your purse, and every day, 10 minutes. 10 minutes only.
I don't have a purse.
Well, you can put it in your hip pocket. If he'd been listening, he would have known that you could put it in your hip pocket. I'll carry yours for you. You don't go anywhere without me. So there you go. Right?
That works.
And we'll all just sit there and with pencils have 10 minutes and a little bit of discipline. Because listen, we all can get better. There's nobody that can't get better. You don't reach to the point. He sketched how the day he died. Because you get better and you can see it. So now here's another one that's really complicated. Check this one out. Look at this. Okay, again, we're talking about the lights and darks. Look how this wall's darker. It gets lighter up here, it goes dark. Here's a big light white window with black. Now remember, I told you, in any painting, your eye will go to the lightest light and the darkest dark first. Okay? So my eye is going right there, and then it is bringing it around. Here's our picture pattern, okay? Again, with our ballerinas coming up this way and around and back. And again, he's told this arm's kind of going up like this. Beautiful. So there's a little bit of white here. There's a little bit of white up there. There's mostly the whites here. And again, you see a teeny bit over here, tiny bit here, and here. So if I had thought about it, I would have printed this out in black and white, and you really would have seen it. Next time I'll do that. You really would have seen it. But again, we came up with this like about 10 minutes ago, so I think we're doing good. Come on. We're doing really good. John, we're trying to figure out. We got this really cool overhead camera up here with a new bar. We've got this camera I'm looking at. We're doing some stuff here. All right. Now, this has got to be one of my favorites. All right. I've got to show you this one. This has got to be one of my favorites. For contrast, very simple. Now,
pull it down a little bit.
Something has gone really wrong in the lives of these two ladies, okay? And you know, we don't even know these women, and we're feeling bad for them, all right? We want to send them chocolates or something, okay? Really want to feeling bad for you. But again, look at the white. Is this dress all white? No. See the little tiny bit of white on the cuffs of this woman on her nose? This, I think, was a pastel sketch, all right? And again, a little bit of white here, down here on the shoes, okay? The bench doesn't have a lot of bright on it. There's more modeling here in this part than on this part of the wall. There's a little shadow here that's bringing you back. And then we've got a touch of blue here on the back of a ribbon and something here, a little touch of blue-gray. Very well done picture. And again, what do we learn from that? He was very judicious. You like that word, judicious? He was very judicious on how he did the white. And you need to be too. We're talking about our own artwork here. How are we going to improve it? I'm going to certainly start paying more attention to this because that's great. And here's my last one. And then I hope we can answer some questions for the new year. This is my last one. Remember I told you he drew all the time.
Pull it down.
He drew all the time, all right? And this is something he just made a habit of doing. And one thing that was kind of too bad about was that his eyesight started to go. He had joined the military for some sort of war in France. I forget which one it was. But anyway, his eyesight was bad, and he was always panicked that he was going to go blind. And he really, at the very end, I think, you can get more of his information off of Wikipedia, I think, is where we got a lot of this. And you know, his eyesight was bad, and you know, as an artist, that's just terrible. And of course, we have so many more ways to treat eye problems today than we did then, and probably in 20 years, you know, they'd just be transplanting whole eyeballs, you watch. But anyway, he had his eyesight problems, so he was more he was really, say that word for me.
No way. I'm not saying that one.
Okay, he was particularly focused on lights and dark, and perhaps his vision had something to do with that. How's that?
That's a good way to put it.
You know, and who else was going blind as a bat too? Was Monet, you know, the guy with all the water lily paintings, right? He started to lose his eyesight too, and everything got more out of focus. Bill, we never quit painting; he just painted something else. All right. So I want you to see this now. Here's the final sketch. Look at that. Is that not fantastic? Do you see the use of the lights here? Look at how light this is. Very judicious. This is not as light on this leg, a little bit here. Look at the hair. Fantastic. Isn't that just fantastic? I love this pastel sketch, all right? And again, emphasizing that. Now, if he'd put white everywhere, light everywhere, wouldn't be so interesting, would it? So that's what we're going to take away from Edgar Degas, that try to be nicer, because it's terrible to die wandering around the streets of France. Who wants to do that? Doesn't sound fun. And, you know, we are all friends here. Let's all be nice on our chats. We're all an artist. I love our live chats because we're learning to make new friends. YouTube is a boon. We're getting out to everybody. Oh, yeah. He had no students. I want to mention that. He had no students. He never taught another person to paint. But Mary Cassatt, who is one of my favorite impressionists, was greatly influenced by him. And a couple other people admired him and collected his artwork. And the other thing I want to say about him in his biography was that like all the artists of his time, okay, they went over to the Louvre and they studied the masters. He painted Velazquez and all these old dead artists that were his old dead artists. You learn from painting paintings from other artists, which is kind of contrary to how art's taught in America, but this is how everybody else in the world understands how to do it. And he did it too. In fact, he got a job, you know, painting for the Louvre, you know, painting old masters. But and the other thing he did, which was really good, is he painted a lot of portraits, which is pretty lucrative if you're an artist too, okay? And if you can paint portraits, that's a good thing. And I've said the reason I can do portraits, but people always want to look kind of better than they are. And so you've got to, you know, if you're too much of a truth teller, probably portraits wouldn't be your bailiwick. Okay.
And mention the artist's name one more time.
We're talking about Edgar Degas. All right. And how he, and what we can take from our work. In other words, we learned a little bit about him. But what can we learn from him to incorporate in our paintings today in our lives? And so we've decided that we're going to be very aware of two things. We're going to watch the lights and the darks and make sure that our picture pattern, you know, we have a good picture pattern. We're designing paintings, and we're going to take black and white photos of our artwork as we paint to make sure that we're getting the right values, turn off the lights at the end of the picture, tone down so there's just a few really bright spots. We learned that light yellow is slightly brighter than white. Haha, something you may not have known. And we know that everybody gets better all the time, and we're going to be doing, we've got, this is our new thing for this year, for 2017, is that every day we're going to do a little sketch, not show it to anybody, a little sketchbook, and date it 10 minutes only of whatever we, wherever we happen to be, wherever we're sitting, just get out, draw something, date it, and move on, okay? And see how much better we get. So that's kind of what we've got. I think that in conclusion, I think we did pretty good. So John, I'm going to open up the floor to questions. You guys like this series because we'll do more. And also I'll probably grab a ballerina occasionally and, you know, have that one as a lesson or whoever we're talking about. We're going to try to bring more of this kind of information to our channel.
Okay, we have a question.
Yeah.
I am always finding reference material online, great ideas, etc. I want to print them. Do you guys have a favorite printer? I will let Ginger go first.
Okay, so yeah. So the thing about printing, you know how they give these printers away at the store, you know? Like $50, you get a printer. And then you go to buy the ink and you found it cost you like $5 to print something. I mean, you're out of ink, and then suddenly and then they say they'll void the warranty if you use, you know, kind of underground inks and stuff like that. I have this great printer. I'll tell you what, when this is over, if you'll ask that question again when we post it up there on YouTube, because this will stay up, I will give you the exact, it's an HP printer, and I pay $5 a month, and I get practically all the color prints I can use. I love it, okay? And because I'm printing stuff out constantly, and every once in a while, if I go over, they might charge me an extra buck, okay?
It's and like it's, 1,000 prints or something? How many prints?
I don't know. It's just, it's the best deal. And I met some people from HP who said, I said, God, not only do I love the printer, because you've got to make a printer for me that, for the technically challenged, that if it doesn't work in about 5 minutes, you know, I'm over it.
Five seconds.
Okay, I'm over it. Right? I'm sorry. You are, you know, there's just every time I learn to do something, and this is how I feel with tech stuff, then change it. And I knew how to print, turn on the old printer. I have no idea how to get this printer on. Well, there's the button. Well, you know, I have glasses. Where is the button kind of thing, right? I don't see any button. Where's the button? But anyway, I like this HP printer. Which one do you like for you?
I use the Canon. It's the professional one for photography. Since I do photographs, I want photorealistic, and I go for the best color renditions, etc.
Yeah.
Mine's a lot more, and the ink's a lot more. Everything's a lot more. For what you need, the one Ginger's recommending is just perfect.
It's perfect.
It just, you know, they give you the ink. You don't have to do anything. It just shows
up. And you don't pay any more for color. See, this would be a bad deal, I think, if you were just printing out letters. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because you get charged by the page, not by the color. So for artists, this is like they just gave us a gift. What do you mean? I can print this full page of color, and they're not, and it doesn't cost any more than printing a bunch of black and white type? Oh, boy, is that ever great.
Sign me up for that.
Sign me up for that. $5 a month, I can do it, right?
Yeah, that was a good one. We had another one down here.
Okay.
Will you do a video on folds and fabric, please? Remember the apple we're going to be doing big?
Yes, we're going to be doing that. We have a video up there, don't we, already on folds and fabric?
I don't think it's on YouTube. I think it's in our members only.
Is it?
It was a YouTube, but we moved it over, I think. I don't remember.
I don't remember.
There's an apple one, a green apple.
That's a green apple with some fabric, and I showed you how to do some folds.
But we're going to do that big.
But we'll do that big, because that was my favorite painting. And I want to do it big, like, you know, like bigger than 16 by 20. How's that? I want to do it bigger. And, yeah. And that's so pretty, because I would hang that in a dining room. I think that would be nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Are we going to paint the picture behind you, Ginger?
Are we going to paint the picture behind me? No, we're not painting the picture behind me. This actually was a commission by Cinnamon's husband, John, when he had a video gaming company. And you'll notice that the horses, if you look behind me, there's knights riding those horses instead of cowboys. And it had to do with something to do with the rift. And he said, look, this is a sign. This is the scenario behind it was, I want this sort of landscape there's cracks in the earth and this light comes up through it and creatures from another world are crossing over into our world. And, you know, that's what I came up with. And then it was like they moved to Canada a few years ago for 1 year, and they couldn't take the painting with them. So I said, I'll tell you what, I'll trade you for something else. And let me keep the, just give me this back, and you can take one, you can move, because this is like $48.60. And then John still wants us back. He really doesn't remember we traded. But he may get it back.
Let's not go there. Family feuds.
Family feuds. No, it's not family feuds. If they want it back, right now they have no room for it anyway. Cinnamon has inundated her house with paintings. Anyway, I like this as a backdrop, so no. But, you know, aspects of this, we talk about aspects. Anything else?
Yes. How do you get gesso out of carpet? Don't put it in carpet first.
How do you, John? You're so funny. Don't put it in carpet first. How do you get gesso? Now, remember, this is what you do. You go to the people that make the gesso and get up on their website and you ask them those questions because they might know.
Because okay? We don't know that one.
Because who knows? I mean, the best thing is to not paint on carpet is to, you know, have you ever seen those plastic things that they go under office chairs so your office chair swirls around? A couple of those under your easel's good. If you've got a room in your house and you like the carpet and you turned it into an art studio, is there any way you can just roll the carpet up and put it in the attic and then when you sell the house, put the carpet back? Something like that? Just a thought? Not that I've done any of those things, but I think it's a good idea. I have friends that do that.
General consensus is people like this series and they like to see more of them.
Okay.
Dawn is asking, can I post the one I did and get your opinion? I'm not sure the one.
Well, you know, here's my thing. Because of the personal art coaching feature we offer on our website, gingercooklive.gallery, our members get personal art coaching, not the weekly members, you know, somebody that signs up for a week, but they send me their paintings. So I'm very, I don't really give opinions other than I think it's great on artwork that's done. But if you're a member, you can send me an original painting or something else, as long as it's not one of Cinnamon's. Cinnamon and I have a pact. We don't talk about each other's artwork, you know, as far as critiquing that kind of thing. But you can send me something, and then I will be happy to comment on it. But particularly if you're a member, that's one of the benefits of having a personal art coach. I am a personal art coach to lots of fans all over the world, and it's really fun to see what you guys paint. But, of course, you can always tag it for me, and we'll put it on our on my Facebook page, too. And I've got a Pinterest gallery board. We got to start a new one for 2017. And if it's one of my paintings that you've done, I'll put it up on my Pinterest board and credit you with it and say, look how good you did. And, if it didn't get up there, it's not because I didn't love it. It's just because life gets busy. But I try to. Okay?
I'm being told that I'm talking softly. Hello?
Oh, this is our test. So this is our sound test. So we appreciate it. We appreciate these things, you know.
All right. I've upped my volume. See if it's louder to you now. Yeah. We'll wait for that to go through.
Yeah, we want to make sure our shadows are good. I'm really loving this camera setup, what we're doing. I think it's great. I like the fact we can show you things like this, like we can show you pictures. Did you show the picture of Degas, the old one, the last one?
I'm afraid I did.
Yeah, with a hat.
Yeah.
And then can you focus on this camera? Let me show you the one that from this one off. I'm going to show you this one. Can you see this portrait right here? Can you focus in on this?
Wait a second. I got to kick over.
Way down here on the thing. I wanted you guys to see.
Slide it down.
This is what he looked like when he got really older. And he's got that set. This is a photograph. And he's just got this attitude, doesn't he? It's funny to me, right?
Okay. So pull it down.
Yeah.
Pull it down.
Keep
pulling down, pull it down.
Yeah.
Okay, right there.
Yeah, see that?
And slide it. I'll move my camera. Okay, there it is. Okay.
Yeah.
Here it comes, guys.
It says here he was characterized as an old curmudgeon. Isn't that a great word?
Oh, an old curmudgeon.
By novelist George Moore.
I like that word.
And he deliberately cultivated his reputation of misanthropic bachelor. Proudly conservative in his political opinion, we'll go on. You'll have to read it. It's just interesting. His life is interesting. I'm telling you what people like to find out about famous people. They manage to dig stuff up out of him anyway. No matter how private he wanted to keep his life, nothing's that private. And anyway, he's interesting. I thought he was really interesting. But boy, what an artist! What an artist! And that's our goal
outside
is to be nice if people said that about us. What an artist! That'd be fun.
John, maybe one click down from where you are. Okay, I've turned it down, so we're on a second setting.
Yep. Okay.
You never know with my voice.
All right. So
what type of light does Ginger prefer painting in? Natural light is what we use whenever possible. If not, we have our daylight bulbs.
Yeah, this was something. There's an artist. I'll tell you what. She's passed away, but I'm going to highly recommend her. Her name was Lily Dahl, and it's spelled D-A-H-L, Lily Dahl. And she was a Texas artist and an oil painter. But she did this video. She has this video, and I think... if you can get this video of hers, it's not on YouTube or anything. You're gonna have to buy it or something, or maybe you can rent it on. You can rent the video. There's a website that rents videos. You know, how-to videos. And I can't think of the name of it right this second. But she had this whole thing on lighting, and I learned so much from her. It's like just because you're an artist doesn't mean you're a framer, right? And just because you're an artist doesn't mean you know the first thing about cameras or computers or lights. And she talked about the daylight bulbs and why you want it. And that was inspired me. And she also talked about, she had a great one on how to set up a still life and how to paint, the best times to paint outdoors if you're going to go out brave outdoors. I really like that. On light and dark, Lily Dahl. And she's a wonderful, wonderful portrait artist too. And again, she has a pile of videos. She died about 5 years ago, but really, really good artist. And I was lucky to meet her one time and talk to her a little bit. And I wanted to tell her how much that helped me. You know, we can learn from everybody. Everybody's got something. That's one thing about it. Everybody's got something they can teach us if we take a little bit of time and just like Degas, what can we learn from him even though he's passed away?
This is probably more of a question to me, but I will read it to you in case you'd like to chime in.
Oh, I always chime in, John.
Do you do any color adjusting before you print? Ginger, go ahead and answer that question.
Well, John does. John does all kinds of color adjustments. Sometimes in my camera, you know, my iPhone, I'll just go back and hit the blanket color adjustment, just the easy, make it better, you know, kind of button. You know, John sits there and too much information, too hard to do. John does it. Yes, he color adjusts all kinds of stuff. That's his favorite thing. I like to do that with my paintings. I color adjust a painting when I'm done. I like to come back the next day and color adjust it too. Look at it and color adjust it. You have that painting of my ocean thing right here. Can you grab that real quick, this one?
Oh, of course. Yeah, I'm just sitting around doing nothing.
I know.
Not a problem.
Just sitting down here doing nothing. I want to just mention that because...
You're talking about this gorgeous?
Yeah, this is, thank you. Well, that's so nice. This was one we've done for the Wave and Water Masterclass. I'll move this. I'll just put this right here. John can show you, right?
Give me a second to get there.
All right, we'll give him a second to get there. You know, every month our Wave and Water Masterclass, you know, we just focus on things in the water, and I do a painting, and the last painting I did was like, I don't know, it was like 7 hours of lesson, and it was just incredible. We're still editing it, okay? Oh. So I had to come up with something else in the meantime. This is like 3 hours.
Our camera.
My main camera, right? And then we're down here on this?
This
camera in here. So, sorry.
Okay, wait. No, not yet. Yes.
Not yet.
You're still on the main camera. I turned the little one off. Slide the picture forward? No, back.
Back
towards you. Yeah, because the camera's rotated on me. Keep coming back.
Yeah.
All the way to the edge.
Yeah.
All the way to the edge.
Yeah.
There we go.
Okay. All right. So you can see this painting with the light, okay. You know what I mean? Again, here I'm trying to do that with my painting with the light, just kind of what I learned from Degas, where you have the light on the dolphin. It's coming down a little bit more softer down here in the waters. But, and again, this was the kind of thing where I would come back maybe a couple days from now. I look at this. There may be something I will change.
Camera.
If I change it, then I will add it, you know, to the lesson. Say, I looked at this for 2 days, and this is what I thought. See? And... you got to do that sometimes, you know, just sit back, look at your stuff for a while, hold it up to a mirror. Is it too light? Is it too dark? How can I fix it? Yeah, okay. So I wanted to throw that out there. Is that, you know, nothing's always, it doesn't have to be perfect, but, you know, and don't go back like 5 years from now and fix your old stuff. This is my hot thing. So come on, this is what you did
back to
then. And you have a record then, because if you're not getting better every month, and I try to get better every month, you're not trying, you know, everybody's getting better and you get more muscle control and more control
back to
of
the main.
Things. More control of things, okay? I think that's pretty good. Do we have any more questions before we sign off? And just, you know, I'm trying to think of people watching this back.
Any tips for setting up a studio painting space at home? Don't use carpet on the floor.
Yeah, don't use carpet on the floor would be the tip number one. yeah, I would say that if you're setting up a studio space at home, have a chair that you can sit in with arms, you know, that goes up and down. I'm telling you what, I'm like the princess and the pea. Over the years, one of the art stores in town, Texas Art Supply, has a whole second floor of just chairs and furniture and easels and stuff. And I think over the years, I've bought all kinds of chairs and stuff, and thinking this chair would be good and that one. And really, I'm down to the thing where I like to sit in a chair with some arms that goes up and down that rolls. I'd say that. And you want to set it up. When you're setting it up, if this was, I'm looking at you, all right, so to my right would be my water down here a little lower, and to my left would probably be all my paints and stuff, and then I have two tables, almost like an L section, you know, U section, like a staple, not even a U section, like a staple, you know, that's, so that you're sitting here, here's your easel. And then on each side, depending on whether you're right or left-handed, you've got stuff. And it's good to always put a fabric towel under your water. Another thing, so you can wipe off. And you need rags in your hand. You need a wastebasket handy. You don't need a lot of space. You really don't. In fact, our videos are set up on our gingercooklive.gallery. Our videos are set up so that if you didn't own an easel and you just had a table in a motorhome, you could make this work. Okay, so it's just, it's nice if your studio is in the living room where you know, then you want better stuff to put your stuff away in. If it's in a room, just depends on how neat you are, you know how perfect it has to be. It would be nice, I mean, ideally speaking, it would be nice to have, you see some of these studios, gosh, go on Pinterest, go on my Pinterest page and look at art studios people would love to have, but most people don't have the room or the space or the funds for that. It's fun. It's fun to dream. Have the best stuff ever.
One more question, and then we're going to go into the fashion questions.
Okay.
Question is, will Ginger ever teach us portrait painting?
Will I ever teach portrait painting? Right now, we're focused on so many different things, and that's not my specialty. You know, like surgeons, I'm a landscape painter. And I'm, an ocean painter.
Still life.
And while I do portraits, that is not my bailiwick. It just isn't. So no, probably not. That's not my deal. But I can, you know, I certainly can paint portraits and I do them. But I would rather focus on the things that I'm really good at.
The things that we want her to dump her brain on.
Yeah, and my brain dump stuff. Because, I mean, that's what I'm known for, is my sense of color and portrait. And occasionally I throw in a portrait, like we did Santa Claus, John and Santa Claus and stuff. I might do a portrait. And animal portraits. You guys, do you have my horse picture anywhere I can show that? That horse picture?
Again, I'm just sitting here doing nothing.
I know. Just anything. I need my animal horsey picture. Because I really do horse portraits and dog portraits and stuff. I'm really good at that, I got to tell you. And he's kind of ruffling through the paintings looking for them. If you haven't seen my animal, if you haven't seen my horse portraits, here we go.
The
thank you.
The camera has slipped.
What slipped?
This camera slipped a little bit.
Uh-oh. No, not slipped.
Yeah, so hang on a second, folks, as we readjust this.
Slipped. Interesting.
Well, I thought it might.
Well, we've got it clamped to an overhead bar, so this is
that's why we're doing this now.
This is why we're doing this live class. You're bearing with us while we play with all the toys. All right, this is my
just wait a second. Hello, I just sat down now.
Good, John. Now he's putting his earphones on. He's going, yeah, sit down. Well, he had to get up. You know, again, we came up with this at breakfast this morning. Hey, we should do something live, test all the equipment, because we go live tomorrow night, 7:30 with a Ginger Crumb, and we want to have this sort of smooth. This is what we're doing. Okay, ready? Can I show this now? Can you see it?
Oh, I need, okay, hold on. No, you're not going to show it yet.
Not showing it yet.
No, because I've got to my camera's tipped the wrong way. Hang in there, folks.
I could turn it around.
That won't really help because my camera's angle's wrong. I got to get up again.
Okay, John's getting up again to adjust cameras, but this is the fun thing. I mean, you couldn't do this with one person. I mean, I'm so lucky that he came down from Michigan and is doing this with me. And I got to tell you that John's knowledge of cameras and lighting and all this stuff is as great as my knowledge of painting. So the two of us make, you know, can put together, I think, something pretty cool. We were really lucky to have that, you know, but found that. And he's a professional photographer and also very artistic, so it makes it for a good thing. Can you see it now?
I can see it now.
You see, this is a hort portrait. You talk about
it. They don't see it yet. I see it.
Well, I'm not here.
No, they see it.
There.
No, put it back down now.
Okay.
Don't put it up.
All right, put it down. Can you see it now?
Yeah, I can. You put the other one side by side.
All right, I want you to show you. I'm showing you how to do, this is a lesson that's coming up in January for our members. Look at that. And you see, this is the, which is the first one I did? I can't even remember now.
I do. Slide them over a little bit. So, yeah, and down a little bit.
Yeah, I think this was the first one.
Yep,
I did.
The girl.
And then he thinks that's the girl horse. And then in the lesson, you know, then I went ahead and did a video lesson on how to do it. And you'll notice that this one I freehanded in, just freehanded. This one I taught you how to grid, how to do the grids and stuff. That'll be coming up in January for gingercooklive.gallery members. So, yeah, so portraits, I've got to show you how to do animal portraits. And the techniques that you use on doing this are the same things you would use for people. Wouldn't change. We're just doing horses. So, and I love horses because I had horses my whole life. So there you go.
Okay, you're still on the little camera because I'm still over here. Are you done down?
I'm done down.
If you're done down, then we can go back to the big camera.
I'm going back to the big camera. All right, so you have a fashion question?
We do have two fashion questions.
Fashion questions.
Yes, I do need a wireless headset like Ginger has, but that's not in the budget. Sorry, guys. Can we see John's work? My work, you're seeing it every time you see a video lesson. That's my work right
that's
now.
That's John's, the video lesson is John's work. And for instance, like on that Wave and Water Masterclass painting that I finished, I just happily sat there and chatted and painted for hours. John's got that many hours and more editing it because there's four cameras that are shooting on that. And then he has to decide where it goes where. And that's not easy. I mean, once we got this set up because we're just so excited to have this big easel with the electric easel, now I can paint bigger pictures. Lots of time goes into editing those and making it interesting for our Wave and Water Masterclass and for our regular classes.
I see. I've done the first day in two sections of the first day, and it's taken me about 16 hours to do the 2 days, the two sections of the first day.
And there's five sections in one day. So we haven't tried it before. We just thought, we got the cameras, everything will work. Didn't think about all the memory that the computer was going to need and all the stuff. But there's a lot going into doing stuff. You know, just saying, can you teach me how to do something big? That's why I try to teach you some small stuff, but you can turn around and make anything bigger.
Yeah, you can. Okay, fashion statements. The shirt you have on, did you paint that?
Oh, is this not the neatest shirt ever?
And she has pants that match it.
And I have pants that match it. This is a Melissa McCarthy
ensemble
that I got off her website. And they're on sale right now, so I got them. And the pants are stretch. And I have to say this about her. She's not a petite woman. And she designed clothes for people that, weren't their ideal weight size anymore. Let me put it that way, right? And, it's all very well to think, at some point I've got another 50 pounds I'm just going to lose. Maybe so. But I thought this, and you can wrinkle this. And
it doesn't wrinkle.
It doesn't wrinkle. Her stuff is fantastic. And it looks like me. It looks like I painted it, doesn't it? I thought it was great. And I thought I could wear it on the show. It would be great. It would be
and,
fun.
And one just came in. What's the masterclass?
The Wave and Water Masterclass is separate from our video lesson library. And this is where you don't have to be a master to do it, but what we try to master a subject. In other words, when you every month I add a video for our subscribing members. And what you do is you focus on that and just, we're learning to paint water, waterfalls, water reflections, all kinds of things related to the ocean waves, so that you become you're so focused on the different ways we focus on how to paint that, from old dead artists who have painted things to current artists to how I paint stuff. I mean, and learn as much as you can about painting water so it becomes second nature to you. And that's fun, and we do new stuff all the time.
And the last question, what's the story about that necklace? That is a gorgeous necklace.
Oh, thank you. You guys, like, you never see me wear jewelry. You'll never see me wear rings on the show, because then the
conversation... Well, you did one time, and everybody went nuts. Why do you have a ring on your hand?
Well, because I didn't take it off before the show. Because I have rings, but I normally don't wear them. For when you're wearing rings, your hand... Now look. See, now suddenly you've got to do something about your fingernails. I mean, you know, because you just put this ring here. Now you've drawn attention to your hands. Until then, what are you going to do with your fingernails? Maybe a little nail polish wouldn't be in order. You know, those kinds of things. So it's like when you get dressed... You know, when you put something on, then you got to have shoes that match. And, you know, it's a thing, right? But now, so I wore this necklace because I thought it would be pretty today, and I'm not painting. This is amber. This is a real piece of amber. This is called butterscotch amber. This is silver. And I got this in Gdansk, Poland, when I was traveling with my girlfriend, Gudrun. And she had a store here in Houston at Old Town Spring, called the German House, and she sold all kinds of amber. So she and I went a few years ago. Oh, this is, gosh, now a few years ago. It'd be 2000 to 2009. No, it was before then. We went to Germany, and we went amber shopping in Gdansk, Poland. And that's a whole new story. That was fun. I love Gudrun. She's carrying around $5,000 in cash to buy all this amber for her store. And she's got it, and she announces that to people. I said, are you trying to get us killed? Shut up with the $5,000 that you've got on your person. Have you looked around? I mean, and she's going, what are you talking about? I said, listen, I know you have money. And she would go into a store that sold amber. I mean, we're in Gdansk, Poland. We hear this is where they've got, this is the amber capital of Poland. And so we go to the regular retail shops, and then she says, well, where did you buy your amber? And, well, why would they tell her? I couldn't imagine why they'd tell her. You know, but and then she says, well, I have all this money and I need to buy amber. And they're going, well, buy ours. I mean, lady, why would we tell you? Anyway, so we kept, I'm thinking, you know, I just need to step back about 10 paces and look out the window, let her talk to people, because I don't want to. Anyway, so that was the story of our adventures in Poland. But she finally, someone broke down and told her where all the factories were and where all the people that made the amber. And so I ended up getting this piece because she was buying so much that, they could throw in a couple. She did get a good deal and threw in a couple pieces that I wanted. So probably if we do more of these video chats, I've got a fantastic amber collection and I'll wear some pieces. I really do have a great amber collection.
Well, I think that concludes our impromptu live lesson of learning, what is it?
From the masters, learning from the masters.
With Ginger Cook. We thank you all for joining us today and look forward to seeing you in the near future.
Tomorrow night even for a live lesson.
That's the near future. Any nearer and it'd be here.
Funny. So tomorrow, all right, 7:30 live on Monday, Tuesday and Wednesdays. We do that.
Yes, and we do that. Tuesday and Wednesday.
Yeah,
live. 7:30 Central Time. That's
Texas time.
Or Ginger Time, as she likes to say.
Yeah, it's my time, yes.
Ginger Time.
We're Time Lords. There you go. All right.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks.